Good morning.
My name is Frederik Lyng. I'm an architect and associate at BIC, and thank you very much for the chance to present this project one more time. This is the project for the Noma restaurant in Copenhagen in Denmark. Now we will sort of jump into the interior of the project in a moment, but I'm just going to zoom out for a short moment to explain you sort of the premise of the project. Noma, if you don't know the restaurant, this is a Danish restaurant in Copenhagen that has risen to become one of the top restaurants on a world level, and has been a huge factor in what you could say is a revolution of the Danish gastronomy, the whole Nordic gastronomy scene, and Danish food culture in general. The name Noma is an abbreviation of the two words in Danish. Nordisk mad means Nordic food. And it is led by the chef at the center of the picture here, René Redzepi, who has a very, very strong ideological approach to creation of food. And they run, as well as the restaurant, a non-profit organization that aims to spread the knowledge of sustainable food culture around the world. So they approached us to do the restaurant in 2015, and we were immediately captured, of course, by the beauty of what is the at the center of the project, namely the food itself, and Noma's focus on using local produce and ingredients that correspond to the seasons in a new type of Nordic gastronomy. So Noma felt that they were, after 10 years in their first location in the city center, they wanted to sort of reinvent themselves and improve some of their practical surroundings in the restaurant. So they had found a new site, which is located in a sort of the fringe area of the center of Copenhagen, on a part of the old city fortifications, a military area outside of the naval base. This was later, after the Navy left, this was converted into a recreational area for the Copenhagen citizens. And during the 70s, it was even squatted in large parts by some free-spirited individuals that created the free town of Christiania in the area. On our site, along with the mound of the fortification, is an old storage facility for loaded sea mines. It was later also squatted and used for raves, graffiti culture, and skating. So we were looking at how to approach this site, and the strict cultural heritage regulations that are surrounding it, the military fortifications in the building, and how to sort of combine that spirit with the can-do nature, the free-spirited nature of the self-built homes of Christiania, and Noma's wish to move to something that had a feeling almost of a traditional Nordic farm. So cultural heritage experts and archaeologists from the Danish Minister of Culture were part of sort of determining in which parts we could actually work. We were mandated to restore the building on the exterior and could work inside. And then other than that, we were limited to the end of the building plus three existing foundations in front. So this was a main factor in the design. Another main factor is the Noma's renewed focus on the seasons, which their menu is now structured around, and the connection between the restaurant and the surroundings and the weather and the seasons changing around you. So the program consists of equal parts front of house and back of house program. We chose to arrange all the back of house program really efficiently into the existing building in a long line, and then we arranged all of the front of house program expressed as individual blocks at the end of the existing structure, and added three greenhouses on the existing foundations in front of the long building. So the front of house program is structured around the two kitchens, the prep kitchen and service kitchen, with the service kitchen in the middle of the cluster of new program front of house area, and which gives you visual connections and an overview for the head chef to finally tune and control the experience of the guests throughout the dinner service. So this creates a sort of small village of seven individual buildings attached to the existing buildings that where each function and the wish for the character of each of these parts of the journey of the visitor, the guest to the restaurant, through the experience is expressed individually, spatially and materially. On the site plan, you can just briefly see the arrival from the east at the street towards the restaurant. This is the plan, the floor, the ground floor plan, with the 7 buildings added to the existing structure and 3 greenhouses in front. As you arrive, you are in the Copenhagen harbor area. Here we see it from above with the mound of the fortifications and the Copenhagen harbor in the back. As you arrive to the restaurant, you are passing the landscape first, the greenhouses, and with a view to the surrounding area. As you approach the restaurant and the front door, you are greeted by this small village of 7 buildings. We had an approach to the interior design that was where it was thought as together with the exterior expression of each of these individual buildings. Some of them more dogmatically than others. In the case of the entrance here, where the guests first arrive, this is a tombak-clad building with an oak interior. You have the wardrobe built into the side, and you have Olaf Williamson's artwork integrated with the skylight at the top of the room, leading you towards the kitchen that is behind the view here. So crucially here, the experience for the guest is not of arriving at a reception desk, but rather there's no desk. You arrive directly into as if it was somebody's home, and you're greeted by the corner of the service kitchen by the chefs themselves. Before entering into the dining room, the guests can take a drink in the lounge, and we see here already how the individual structures, this is the brick lounge structure that is sort of separated with this small internal street of terrazzo pavement and the glass roofs that separate the buildings from one another. We have the fireplace at the corner, transition between the street and the interior flooring material, and you have the ceiling here of the lounge stepping down towards the corner window that can open up completely during the summer months with a view of the surroundings. As we move towards the dining space, you see here how the street and the glass roof again are bridging the gap between the existing structure and the in this case the service kitchen at the middle. We work a lot with the detailing of the glass roof and the integration into the solid surfaces of the individual buildings to sort of make a seamless connection and give you the impression that you are stepping outside when you're stepping between the individual structures. You can see from above the glass roof here how some of the roofs are protruding up through the glass roof with the same material as is on the sides. So moving from the service kitchen into the dining space, in this space we took this approach of one volume, one material to a little bit to its extreme. So it's conceived as a stack of oak planks from the floor coming up into the wall, stacking up into the ceiling with integrated acoustics and lighting, and even on the exterior cladding of the roof. This is seen during the vegetable season during the summer, and this is a picture from where the interiors or decoration changes along with the seasons to the seafood season in the winter. A long skylight along the top of the building provides some extra daylight and ventilation during the warm summer months. As we move into the private dining room, here we change the material palette to a different type of wood, so all the surfaces here are instead on the interior are Douglas pine with the charred wood on the exterior of the building and the roof. A large sliding door regulates the visual connection between the service kitchen and the private dining room. And towards the other side, a sort of warp in the roof shape opens the building up towards the mound and the overgrowth on it, as well as the remains of the graffiti on the walls surrounding the plot. The ventilation systems in the building are built, integrated into the walls and roof with the CNC cut detailing into the wooden surfaces for grills and so on. Stepping back a little bit to see a bit closer on some of the details here, we have a special focus on corner details in the building, transitioning from either around the corner of the same material, or in the case of the lounge where we merge two different shades of brick. One of the remaining two small structures here, the waiter room, a tiny 10 square meter structure of board form dark concrete, and the barbecue, which is an external unheated ventilated space that is shaped as a giant metal grill. Inside of the existing building, we have the auxiliary functions such as the fermentation laboratory and the prep kitchen itself, where we cut large skylights into the existing roof and left elements of the old building, such as the crane to move the mines around. We see some integration of artworks in the building here, where we sandblasted the interior of the existing structure. You see the board formed concrete to the right, and we rendered the exterior of it in its original material on the picture of the left.
Thank you.
Thank you. There's a lot to tell.
First question. You've gone to a great deal of effort to create a reference to Nordic vernacular with many buildings, and yet the up close dining experience seems to me to be quite sanitized, given the fact that this place has a history. You've tended to eradicate much of the history, it seems to me. But in particular, when you're at the table setting, the table itself is super Scandinavian normal. Why is that?
Everything, as you can probably imagine, is nothing is left to any circumstances here, and this is a specific
whist. That's a fairly normal table setting, normal chairs, normal lamp.
Yes. Everything is, I will say though, that you can see in the picture, including the furniture, is custom designed for the project. The light fixtures, the tables, the chairs, everything.
They look so normal. Why?
True. You can say that the restaurant wanted, once you're inside of the dining room,
to greenhouses and grasses and villages and all of that.
Of course, it's part of the experience for the visitor, but once you are sat
I
at your table,
kind of let it go at the table level. Anyway, personal opinion, Mary.
I was just wondering about the wider context and what has happened to the other buildings around Christiana, and like how has this your development of this exclusive restaurant affected the rest of the area?
Luckily, nothing whatsoever. The community of Christiania is a very strong-minded one, and the Danish state have been trying to move some of those people out of the area for decades without luck. So it takes much more than the introduction of a restaurant to the area to cause any kind of issues for these people. I think that they appreciate that somebody has taken care of the landscape. This is a home to a lot of birds in the area, and they are having bees on site as well, so they are sort of caring for a little part of the local ecosystem there. I think that the local residents of Christiania are appreciating this. They are fine with it. Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm not going to repeat Nigel's question because I was going to ask the same, but I'm going to ask something else. You said that it's a non-profitable organization. And now I think that as far as the building, the architecture is concerned, you know, there are lots of materials, details, compositions, and so on, which is not terribly cheap. Neither the interior is cheap. So how does it work? Because I think that it is quite a complex, you know, design, which I think that was not really somehow in keeping with your introduction, that it is a very basic space.
Yes and no. So there are two parts to the organization around the restaurant, and one is the restaurant itself, which is sort of one entity, and another run by some of the same people is the non-profit organization. So a lot of the same staff are using sort of the back of house functions and have their day-to-day appearance in and around the restaurant space outside of when the guest service is running, but the restaurant runs also independently as a what is a fine dining experience, of course. So
is it expensive?
Yes. So a profitable business.
How much is an average spend at dinner?
If I remember correctly, in Danish crowns, the menu is what is it in euros? Something along the line of 350 euro for the food, a wine menu for 200 euros, something like that. For each person, yes. So it is an expensive dinner. Yes.
It is a gastro place.
Anyway,
Annabelle,
sorry.
I liked a lot the first image, like of the chef amongst like old wood and all these chef also around him, and also the first image of a kind of squat place who And I think Christiana was like that, but now it's a different community, it's much more mixed. But I think that I don't find it again in the new proposal that I found a bit ambitious. That means I'm a bit lost with a number of reference of wood or burn wood, and at the end I have some difficulties to find the spirit of the first pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. It's an extraordinary sight and a beautifully detailed proposition of pavilions. I have two questions for you.
Yes.
One is, you talked about the sustainable food culture that's behind NOMA, and I'm interested in how those values are reflected in the work. Mm-hmm. And then another question is that amazing image of the graffiti space covered in that work, and I'm wondering what happened to that.
Okay, if we address the first question first, so we in selecting the majority of the, first of all, we will say that we try to minimize whatever we added to the site, both for cultural heritage but also for sort of ecological reasons. As I say, this is a home to a lot of birds that are nesting in the area, so we try to stay as much away from the water's edge as we can, have the smallest possible footprint, and then. We source the materials from locally as much as possible. So the wood that you see in the dining space here is 90% Danish oak, and this is the same with the Douglas pine. We try to source everything locally, and to take the same approach of sort of gathering the elements to the building around us as much as possible. The granite in the terrazzo is from Sweden, I believe. Some of it might be from Bornholm, which is part of Denmark, and so on. So this was our approach for the materials. And of course, we incorporate an efficient ventilation system, glazing, that heating system built into the building that means that it functions efficiently.
And the graffiti?
So the graffiti, there was an image from the private dining where you can see parts of it that has been left in the back here. I don't know if you can see it towards the left of the image. So you see some of the walls that are left there. And then inside of the existing building, we left some of the walls with the graffiti on. So it's sort of, it's tucked away a little bit at the back somehow. The restaurant, they felt that they could show a little of it, but, you know, it's a balance.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.